have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship Christ the Lord. Worship him.
You may be seated for a moment unless you had a birthday in December, in which case you need to come down here and let us bless you this morning. So December birthdays, come on down. Thank you. Look at here, look at all these December birthdays. All right. Very good, very good. Y'all can stand, some of y'all can stand over here if you want to. That way we're kind of balanced out here. Or not. December birthdays, look at y'all. Man, we got a line. Oh, they're giving you some money, so with the Lord, we don't want you in trouble. All right, wow. Great month for birthdays here. What was something that was a blessing for you on your birthday this year? Family. Betsy? Oh, now come on. Y'all don't do the same answer. Family?
We went to Haskell and had a big birthday party.
Went to Haskell, had a big party?
I was traveling.
Traveling? Okay, that can be good. That can be good. You don't know. Would you get something? Did you have a cool present? You don't know? Okay, you're still alive. I guess that's a good blessing. How about you?
I was with my friends.
You were with your friends?
Another work day.
Just another day at work. All right. Well, we're going to sing happy birthday to these folks. And when we get to the name part, we'll just say God bless you when we get there. So let's sing happy birthday. Happy birthday. I'll give them a round of applause. Happy birthday.
We're going to switch our hymns around. We're going to sing number 254, We Three Kings first, verses 1, 2, and 3. Please rise.
Star of royal beauty.
Amen. Greet each other in the name of the Lord this morning. As you return to your seats, first of all, Happy New Year to everyone, and thank you. You may be wondering why in the world would we sing a Christmas hymn on the Sunday after Christmas with We Three Kings, but in the church calendar, this is known as Epiphany Sunday. That is the Sunday that we celebrate the coming of the wise men to honor Jesus, and we'll hear a little bit more about that in the message, so that's why we did sing that hymn this morning. As far as announcements go this morning, just a few things in going on in the community. At 2 o'clock this afternoon, if any of you are involved in the county stock show, you need to be down at the show barn to set up the pens and the inside of the building and get it ready for the stock show, which will be coming up this coming Saturday on the 7th, starting at 8 o'clock in the morning. So that's going to be a big week in the lives of our kiddos who are involved with FFA and 4-H. As they get ready to show their animals this coming week. Are there any other community activities, anything else we need to announce this morning? Okay, as far as joys are concerned, I want to just share a note that was given to Harold and Georgia Keeter from Lois Timmons, and it says this, and it's to the ladies who did the gift wrapping. So it says, "Dear ladies, you'll never know how much you helped me by wrapping my gifts. The girls loved their earrings and I loved the wrappings. This was really an act of love you gave to the community. I and others you helped will never forget your kindness. Thank you. Sincerely, Lois Timmons." So just a neat joy there to see someone who was blessed by that outpouring of love that you guys gave us when you wrapped those presents on those 2 days before Christmas. So I thought that was neat. What other joys can we share this morning other than the fact we had, hopefully everybody had a great Christmas and got to see friends and relatives and spend time together? Yes, Raina? You got your ears pierced. Wow, that's a big deal. Okay. Did it hurt? A little bit? Okay. Well, I'd be worried about you if it didn't hurt a little bit. Sandra? All right, Chip Neese. Okay, wonderful. And where is that name on there? Help me out. Line four. Yep, okay. Well, it's always a joy to take somebody off the prayer list because they're doing better. That's always a wonderful thing. Any other joys to share with us this morning? Yes. Well, it's good to have them. If you didn't hear that, Teresa's mom and dad have moved down here from Colorado. They're living in the house just north of the Hanses. They're right behind Teresa and Randy, and so they're here in our community. And hopefully if you get a chance to this week or next week, come by and help make them feel welcome to our community. That is, I know, a joy for them to have them here close. What other joys? Bob and Ruby Bowles. Bowles. Bob and Ruby Bowles. Any other? Yeah, Austin got his first elk. Did I see a picture of Taylor with a deer too? Okay. So
my boys are on cloud nine right now.
I bet that's right.
It's a joy for me to have to go back to school tomorrow.
What else? All right. Well, let's take a look at our list of prayer concerns this morning. I got a text last night that we needed to put Trey Hudson on the prayer list. He possibly may have bypass surgery coming up soon. They don't know for sure when and if that's going to happen, but I was just asked to put him on the list so that we could be praying for him.
Troy.
Did I say Trey? I'm sorry, Troy. Troy Hudson, my bad. Yes, Hank, Caitlin and Ryan's son, Hank. God, I can't talk this morning. Hank has RSV, So we need to be praying for healing for him and just watching over that family. We got a lot out with sick with the stomach bug and things like that right now. So just pray for our little kiddos who are suffering from all that going around. Yes, Joanne. Okay. Well, if she's not on there, we'll put her back on there.
So, Phyllis
Cole. Okay, Phyllis Cole. All right. Barbara Walker, I believe. Is she on our list? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, and I heard that she fell. Is that correct? Broke a hip?
She's in rehab
now for that. Okay, so we'll continue to pray for Barbara. Any others this morning? Okay, well, before we have our pastoral prayer, we're also going to bless a shawl this morning. As many of you know, Mac Pirtle is going to be having some major surgery in the next couple of weeks. He has esophageal cancer. They're going to be going in to remove that tumor and continue his treatment. And it's a blessing of our church to be able to give our prayer shawls and lap shawls. This is actually a lap shawl that he can have with him as he goes through this treatment. And even though he's not here this morning, we want to go ahead and get it to him so he can have it. And so we're going to go ahead and bless that this morning. So Candy's going to have everybody, if you could, come down and place your hands on the shawl, and we'll pray for him this morning. And she's going to read the blessing this morning. And if it gets crowded down here, you can just place your hands on the shoulder.
Put your hand on somebody in front of you.
Place your hands on the shoulder of someone who is touching the lap shawl, and then we can get everybody in contact here and pray a blessing for Mac and over this shawl.
Okay, we're going to do this one just a little different. I'm going to say a little blessing, and then with your eyes closed, put your own little prayer in for Mac, okay, before we release, all right? Because this is to him. All right. Mac, we place in your hands this symbol of comforting hope, a lap prayer shawl, a little hug from God to carry you through your day. May the presence of someone praying for you bring comforting hope, peace, and safe harbor, found in each prayerful stitch created especially for you. God bless you in the coming days. Amen.
And we'll get that to him this week so that he can have it with him as he prepares to go for his surgery. Prepare our hearts to go to the Lord in prayer this morning.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a living sanctuary for you.
Let's pray. God, we come to you this morning thankful that we can come into your house on this beautiful morning and fellowship with one another and pray with each other and just worship you, Lord. So God, we just pray that you would open our hearts and our minds to receive the word that you have for us today. May it be a word that would challenge us, comfort us, renew us, give us strength to leave this place and go into this new year and be your disciples to the world around us. We lift up these on our prayer list this morning, and we just pray that you would be with those, each and every person, in the way that they need you the most right now, that they would feel your presence. And as we pray for them during the week, if there's a way that we can reach out to them and show them the love of Christ by a phone call or a visit or just a word, Lord, help us to do that in some way this week. We thank you, Lord, for the joys in our lives, the time that we got to spend with family and friends over the holidays, the gifts that we received, just all of the many blessings that you give us. Help us to never take them for granted. We pray for those who need you this morning. We pray for this community, Lord, for those who are waking up this day who don't know what it means to have the hope that we have in you, who just think they know what it means to be a follower of Christ but really don't have you as a part of their lives. And we pray that you would help us by our actions to be a light in the darkness for them. We continue to lift up this nation, Lord. As we enter into this new year, as we enter into newly elected people taking office this morning, Lord, who will make decisions that affect all of us, we pray that you would guide them, give them wisdom, give them the desire to seek your wisdom and guidance. And Lord, we pray for those in our world this morning who can't come into a place like this. It's so easy sometimes to just worry about our own little problems here in our country and think that we have problems, but in so many places in the world this morning, churches are being burned. People are being killed for their faith. Lord, we pray that you would just give our brothers and sisters in Christ strength and that you would bring deliverance to them, Lord. And when we come to those times when we don't know what to say or even how to pray, help us remember we can always pray with confidence the prayer you taught your disciples when you prayed. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, if I could have some ushers gather, we'll take our morning offering. Let us pray. God, we pray that you would bless this offering that we give. May we give with cheerful hearts. May these funds be multiplied and used for your glory here in Throckmorton and around the world. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Please rise for the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
You may be seated. Well, as I said earlier, this is the Sunday in the church year where we celebrate the coming of the wise men to worship at the feet of the newborn Jesus. And that's why our scripture reading this morning is Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. So hear the word of the Lord this morning. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all of the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I may too go down and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child and his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You know, one of the greatest joys of being a parent are the gifts that you get from your kids when they're little. You know the ones I'm talking about, those handmade gifts, the drawings, the sculptures, the decorated rocks, all of those little gifts that you get from your kids when they're little. Not long ago, as I was going through a box that had some of my dad's things in it, I found in the bottom of that box something that I had made for him when I was just a little boy. Now, I was probably about 6 or 7 years old when I made that gift, and it was one of those things probably made at a vacation Bible school one summer. But what it was it was a rock about that big. And obviously it was made to be a paperweight, for it would be a rock that big. But it was painted red, and it was covered with all those little different shaped macaronis and glitter. And it had my name on the bottom. It didn't have the year, so I'm not sure how old I was, but it had my name on the bottom. And it was just amazing to me, out of all of the gifts that my dad had gotten over all those years, talking probably 40 years worth of stuff, he kept that rock. He kept that gift. And quite honestly, it wasn't a very pretty rock. It was a pretty ugly rock, if you really want to know the truth. But why? I mean, why do any of us keep those kinds of presents made for us by our kids? Well, it's simply that. It's because they were handmade presents for us, made by our kids. I'm sure some of you have some in your minds right now, maybe some things that your kids made for you, or maybe something you even made for your own parents. And I have various pictures and sculptures and other crafts that have been made for me by my kids over the years. And, you know, honestly, some of them I could recognize, and some of them I had a kind of a hard time figuring out what they were. But regardless, they're priceless. They're priceless. They're priceless to me because they represent the hearts of my children. It's, you know, the gift wasn't the thing that was given. The gift, in that sense, was the giver. It was the giver. Because that gift represented the best of what they had to offer at that particular time in their little lives. And so that makes those gifts priceless. And one of my favorite images at Christmas is that of the wise men traveling to Bethlehem on their camels, going across the desert, searching for the Christ child, following this star that they had seen. And, You know, it, obviously it must have been a very long journey for them, and you can just imagine their apprehension, and they get anxious as they approach Bethlehem, and they know they're getting close, and there's just a few more miles to go. And the wise men look down from the star and they see a little house lying below its light. And this is where they will find the newborn King of the Jews that they had read about in the scriptures. And this picture of the wise man is very popular. You know, it's on our Christmas cards. It's in our little nativity sets that we set up in our living rooms at Christmas time. And we see the wise men there with the shepherds and the angels, and everybody's all together in this one big magnificent scene when the baby's born on Christmas. But I'm sure most of you are aware of the fact that these wise men don't really belong with the manger scene. There are a number of indications that suggest that they arrived quite some time later, after Jesus' birth in the stable. If you read the scriptures there, Jesus is no longer referred to as a baby. He's called a boy or a child. And the wise men found the family not in a stable, but in a house. Some have suggested that Jesus may have even been between the ages of 1 and 2 years old when they came, because why else would Herod have ordered the deaths of all of the baby boys 2 years of age and under when he sent his soldiers to Bethlehem? Perhaps the star didn't even appear until Jesus was actually born, and then the wise men began their journey. And that's one reason why I'm glad the story of the wise men is told apart from the actual celebration of Christmas, when we focus on Jesus' birth and the choir of angels and the shepherds, because if we included it all in there together, we might miss something that the wise men have to offer to us. They might kind of get lost in the shuffle. I mean, there's a lot of things we don't know about them. We don't really know how many of them there were. Tradition tells us there were three simply because of the three gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh, but some speculate that there might have been a whole caravan of wise men who came to Bethlehem. We really don't know for sure what their names were. We don't even know for sure where they came from. We just know they came from the east somewhere. We also know that they obviously studied the stars and were familiar with the Hebrew scriptures, but Matthew doesn't give us any other details than that. But one of the facts that Matthew does give us is that the wise men came with special gifts for the newborn king. It says they went into the house and they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they knelt down and worshipped him, and they brought him their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Have you ever wondered why in the world did they bring him gold, frankincense, and myrrh? What do those have? I mean, that's not something you give at a baby shower. I mean, how many of you have given that to somebody and brought your little baggie with your frankincense in there and gave it to somebody at a baby? You know, we don't, it's not, those are not gifts you think of when you think of baby gifts. And there's been a lot of speculation over that too over the years. Some speculate that these gifts were the principal items used by these wise men in their magic arts. And so in giving the Christ child these gifts, they were handing over the tools of their trade, in a sense, demonstrating that they were no longer pagan dabblers in magic, but they were letting go of that and committing to following a new way, the way of Christ. Others have reasoned that the gifts were symbols of who the baby was. The gold was obviously given to royalty. So they recognized that Jesus was a king, and so they're giving him some gold. Frankincense was also a very expensive perfume that was traditionally given to people of wealth and people of royalty. And myrrh was not only used for embalming the dead, but it was also for anointing purposes. And so they were maybe giving him to that, foreshadowing his suffering and death, the Savior of the world. We just don't know for sure. And these gifts seem rather useless gifts, but then when you think about it, what do you give this child? What could you possibly give this child who is the all-powerful God, who literally controlled the stars to such an extent that a particularly bright star led the wise men to him? I mean, what possible gift could you give such a king? And when one considers the greatness of the gift that we have been given through Christ, the wonder and the majesty of it all, eternal life, that's a gift we've been given by Christ. A relationship with the living God, that's a gift we've been given through Jesus Christ. What could we possibly give in return? I mean, even the wise men with their gifts must have realized that these gifts they gave were hardly adequate for this child king. The God who has become a human and now sits at his mother's feet. But maybe that's just the point. We, like the wise men, are simply blown away by the awesomeness of God's love that led him to become flesh in a little child. And we fall to our knees and fumble in our purses for a gift worthy of such a thing. But what could we give? God's gift to us is just too great, too wondrous for us to find a gift worthy of return. And maybe that's always the way it is with our gifts to God. All the gifts that we offer in worship, our praise, our music and singing, the words of our liturgy, the words we mutter in prayer, this church building, the bricks, the glass, the timber, the offering we drop in the plate. They're just gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Small gifts in comparison to God's goodness and love toward us. All we can do is to offer God the best of what we have at the moment. Or perhaps there's another way of looking at it. As I said earlier, I can remember when my kids would make gifts out of clay for me. There were times, and there are still times, and today I have no clue whatsoever what that gift is, what it's supposed to be. But I did know this. It was them. They were giving me a piece of themselves with every gift because they poured their hearts and souls into every work. They still do. So even though I might not recognize it, I love it because I love them. And I know they love me. You see, the best gifts that we can offer the Christ child are the gifts of ourselves. In actual fact, the gold, frankincense, and myrrh of the wise men are trivial and quite useless to the God of all creation. I mean, he has all the gold, frankincense, and myrrh he ever needs. He is the creator and owner of these things, after all. But as useless as these gifts are for God, they are a sign of the way the wise men gave of themselves. Notice they went into the house, and when they saw the child with his mother Mary, they fell down and worshiped him. See, God didn't necessarily see the gold and the frankincense and the myrrh. The gift was the giver. The gift was the giver. Just as when you're son or daughter or grandchild gives you that painted rock with macaroni all over it. You don't see that. You see their heart. The gift is the giver, not the thing that is given. That's the best gift that we can give to God. We can't ever give him enough money. We can't ever give him enough time. We can't ever, those things are good and we should give of those things in our lives. But if we're not giving it out of our heart, if it's not an expression of love, if we're not giving it from ourselves, then it doesn't mean much to him. Today we celebrate the beginning of a new year. As the old year ends and the new year begins, many people reassess where life is taking them. And they make New Year's resolutions or promises to themselves that things are going to be different this year. And that might take the form of looking for a new job, seeking to improve relationships, determining to take a new direction. And this is the first Sunday of the new year. And having heard about the gifts of the wise men, I suppose this would be a good time to take another look at our response to the God who was born in a bed of hay just for us. And I'm not just talking about money and what we give in the offering plate, though that's a part of it. I'm talking about the things we offer to God and the motivation behind those gifts. I'm asking, how well have we given ourselves to God in response to His wonderful gift to us? How readily and regularly have we spent time with God in worship, in prayer, in reading His Word? How readily and regularly have we given of ourselves and our time to someone who needs love and compassion? How readily have we shown that this King rules in our lives by letting Him make a difference when we are confused, lonely, or devastated by what life throws up? How well have we used our gifts to do our work honestly and well? How readily have we given God not second best, not what's simply good enough, and not just out of a sense of duty and obligation, but how well have we given God the best of what we have to offer simply because we love Him? See, the wise men went home by another road. We too can walk a different road this year. A road where we can make the King of Kings the living, active center of everything we are and do. The challenge in front of each of us is to make each breathing moment a gift worth giving to the King. God gave Himself to us because He loves us. May His love be reflected in our lives as we worship Him with all that we have, because that's our goal, frankincense and myrrh. When John Wesley started the Methodist tradition in England, he composed a prayer, and it was tradition in that time to every year on the first Sunday of the year to have members of the churches read this prayer, this covenant prayer, as a way of recommitting their lives to Christ. And I've neglected to do that in the past, but I think it's a powerful prayer. I think it's a great way to start out the new year. And I've kind of tweaked the language a little bit because this was written back in the 1700s, so it was kind of hard to understand for some people, or most people. And so I kind of changed it a little bit so we can understand what he's asking us to covenant. And remember, a covenant is, it's kind of like a promise. It's a promise between you and another person, and this is our covenant with God. And so I've asked Candy if she'll put it up on the screen, and what I'd like to do is have us all read it together as a covenant prayer as we close the message this morning and before we take communion together. Read this as a covenant between you and God as you begin this new year. So please read with me. I am no longer my own, but yours. Put me to what you will. Put me with whom you will. Spur me to action. Give me patience in waiting. Let me be employed for you, or laid aside for you, exalted for you, or brought low for you. Let me be full, let me be empty. Let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to your pleasure and disposal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine and I am yours. So be it. In the covenant which I have made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen. May that be your prayer for this year. To not give just because you're supposed to, but just like you were when you were a little boy or girl, or just like your kids or grandkids do now, give out of love. No matter what it looks like, you give out of love. And what a wonderful way to enter into that new commitment than by sharing in the Lord's Supper this morning as a way to come together as one church. And so now let us prepare for Holy Communion. The words of the liturgy are on the screen, but if you'd prefer to follow along in your hymnal, you may. It begins on page 12. Hear the invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. Then the great thanksgiving is found on page 13. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. When we take communion, our invitation is simply this. Anyone who loves him, earnestly repents of their sin, and seeks to live in peace with one another may take communion. You do not have to be a member of our church in order to take communion. We invite everyone to come. Let those who are assisting please come forward at this time. The table of the Lord is ready. Come as you feel led. You'll come and kneel at the altar, and we'll come by and serve you.
Thank you.
Take your red handle and turn to number 170 as we sing, Oh, How I Love Jesus. Please rise.
Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit, and to the honor and glory of God the Father, remind you always that the gift you give is yourself. And may you give all of yourself to Him in this coming new year. Amen.